Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved of the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, for which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in this stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
remain with us and bless us. Preserve us from greed and the cares of this life, that we may seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, and in all things needful for body and soul, experience your constant help. Through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one true God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for the seventh Sunday after Trinity is from Genesis chapter 2. Then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. The Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed, and out of the ground the Lord God made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A river flowed out of Eden to water the garden, and there it divided and became four rivers. The name of the first is the Pishon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold. And the gold of that land is good. Delium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is Gihon. It is the one that flowed around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is the Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in that day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." This is the word of the Lord. Things of which you are now ashamed. The end of those things is death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God, the Father, before all worlds, God, God, light, light, very God, very God. No less than his brother out of jealousy. And
that's a true indication of human sin. That's a true indication of where we are in this whole project of human civilization. From the very beginning, we're taking others' lives, and even to this day, we continue to take other people's lives because of human sin. And so then a legitimate question is this really what God intended? Right? Is this what the purpose of the creation was from the very beginning? And the answer to that is no, absolutely not. And this is what the reading from the Old Testament is all about, Genesis chapter 2. Because there you have that description of the beginning. There you have that description of what God intended from the very beginning. And what we see is God, who creates Adam, creates the first man. Now, at that creation, interestingly enough, it's not out of nothing, but he forms him out of the available dirt, and he breathes the breath of life into him, and he becomes a living being. And Adam takes that man, God takes that man, takes that Adam, and what he does is he puts him in this place, he puts him in the Garden of Eden. Now, we think about that garden, and maybe we don't talk about this enough. That garden is, by intention, separate from everything else around it. It's a holy space. God puts Adam into that place, and notice he gets this commissioning from the very beginning to do what? To work there and to take care of it. To keep it in that place, to keep it in that situation where it's not like everything to the outside, but it's a special place, a unique place, a set apart place. And what it's been set apart for is man and God together in a very particular way. Now, God's everywhere. We know that. And we can never say that's not true. And if you're on your own and you're out in the wilderness or you're here or there, wherever you are, God is absolutely present and God is with you. You never deny that. That's true. But God does establish these certain places, particular places where he places his presence. And that's so we can kind of feel it, experience, and know it at a deeper level than just what's going on in the background. God is always with me. And in this case, God is present with Adam. There's no sin to consider yet. No sacraments necessary to overcome sin. But you do have God, you do have humanity, and you do have the word, the conversation, the love, the community. All of those good things that we have were first experienced by Adam himself in the garden. So as a side note then, this is the reason why we think about church buildings the way we think about church buildings. Because they are different. Sure, it's brick and it's wood and it has ceiling tiles and roof tiles, and a number of them did fly off with the wind. That's all true. So it's normal like every other building, not protected in a special way in that sense. But what makes this place unique and special and wonderful is this is the place where the people of God have gathered to receive and hear the word of God for them. All that the scriptures have, all that God has to say to them, we hear that here. To receive the forgiveness of sins in baptism, to receive the forgiveness of sins in the Lord's Supper, to receive the forgiveness of sins in holy absolution. To pray together, to share one another's burdens. How did you get power? When did it go out? That kind of thing. I mean, this is a special and unique place because we're here and God is here with us. God is here for us. And you just don't get that everywhere else. And so this is the reason why we're trying to maintain the building and keep electricity going and keep the urban going and everything else, because it helps with everything else that's going on here, the most important things that are going on here. But like you saw before, if electricity goes out, the copiers don't work, and the ark doesn't function, we're still the church of God. We still have the word of God. We still have the forgiveness of sins and life and salvation. And even death itself cannot deprive us of those kinds of things. We just receive them in full, in a fuller sense, if we receive death. So did God intend for the world to be this way? The answer is no, absolutely not. And look at what happens with Adam. Look at what's going on in the garden. Look at the kind of care that's being given to Adam. Kind of care that Adam is given to in order to maintain this community, live in this community. Well, then you have the command that's given to Adam. And this is beyond 10 commandments that are written on his heart, beyond what's given in the image of God. And the command is this: pretext here. You can eat whatever you like, except you may not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I think about this tree of the knowledge of good and evil more than what's reasonable, to be honest. Because what is this tree? Well, it's the knowledge of good and evil. And God prevents Adam, and later prevents Eve, from eating of it. Right? Isn't it good that we have knowledge? Isn't it good that we have a knowledge of the good, a knowledge of evil? Well, that's the devil's argument, by the way. And that's what Eve says as she's picking the fruit. Looks good for food. It's desirous to be wise like God and to know good and to know evil. Therefore, we do these kinds of things. These are all good, stacked one on top of the other. But what they go against, and the reason it's sinful, is because it goes against the plain word of God. The clear word of God. And when God said, do not eat of that tree, he doesn't say why to us. He doesn't give a full explanation to us. He's God and we're not. And what the tree demonstrates to us, what the tree points out is that from the very beginning, Adam and Eve were in a particular kind of relationship with God where they had to trust God. And that's what the tree's all about at the end. Don't eat. I'm not going to tell you why. Sure, good knowledge of good and evil is a good thing, but you're going to have to wait. I kind of think in the end, they would have eaten from that tree, but because of sin, they did eat, they did grasp that fruit, but they took it in a sinful way, they took it in a way that God had not intended, and that ruined everything. It ruined the world, that's what sin's all about. But the main point here is even Adam and Eve before the fall, even Adam and Eve without sin, were in a relationship with God where they had to trust God. God was their God and he was their people. And it was evidenced there in the tree. And when they reached out, the biblical word for this, but the sinful word for this is grasped. The gospel word, the good word is given. You're given the word of God. You're given the forgiveness of sins. You're given Christ who is your Savior. You're given life. You're given baptism. You're given the Lord's Supper. The sinful word, the demonic word is the grasping, the taking, the seizing when you have no right to do so. And that's what sin is, and that's what sin was. And so sin comes into the world then by way of this grasping, this seizing, this rejecting the word of God, even with the best of intentions. It's good to eat. It looks pretty good. Hey, I want to be smart like God. But because it is that violation, because it is that rejection of God and his word, this is how sin comes into the world. So kind of follow-up question. If God did not intend for the world to be this way, it's the consequence of sin. Does God intend to leave it in this particular state? Right? The famous, you made your bed and you get to sleep in it version of things. Is that God's intention to say, there's a law in the world, you know what the law was, you broke the law, and now you bear the consequences of the law? Because God could do that. That is entirely righteous, that is entirely just, that is entirely legal, so to speak. You knew what the law was, you broke the law, you knew what the consequences were, therefore you received the consequences. Does God intend to leave us in such a state? Does God intend to leave us to bear the consequences of our sin ourselves? And this is where the epistle reading comes in, but this is where the book of Romans is really, really, really on the spot, on the point. Because there you see in the end as a kind of summary, the wages of sin, death. That's true. But the free gift of God, notice the difference. Wages of sin are what you get and what you earn. The free gift of God, what's given, is eternal life. And eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. So how does that work? How does that fit in with what we're saying? Well, it works in this way. Just as sin comes into the world by the fall, by Adam, by Eve, and that's how this whole thing is started, God, who does not desire to leave us in our sins, God, who desired from the very beginning to establish this relationship, this community, this bond of love between God and the creation, between him and us, has decided, has determined, in fact, before the foundation of the world, to do all things necessary to overcome our sins, to do all things necessary to redeem us from what we have created for ourselves. And so sin comes into the world through Adam and Eve, and then Christ comes into the world with the purpose of taking away those sins, blotting out those sins, removing those sins from us. But it's not so simple as just simply saying, "You're forgiven." That would be the easiest part of it. Because there really is a God, because there really is a law, because all these things are real things, because the wages of sin actually are death, what that means is that God himself will have to bear the burden. God himself and Jesus Christ will have to bear the cross, bear the price. And this, in fact, is what his life is all about. There are certain things about Jesus that people ask about, that I ask about. And sometimes people say, well, this just means he's not the divine person. For example, talking about wisdom, talking about knowledge again. In the garden, Adam and Eve say, it's good to have knowledge, we're getting it no matter what, we're taking the apple. But listen to these statements from Jesus when he says, there is a knowledge that the Father has, which I do not possess, like the last day. That there will be the last day, no problem. When that last day, Jesus says, the Father possesses it, but I don't. Now that's a crazy kind of a statement because this is the omniscient Lord. But what Jesus is showing us, what Jesus is teaching us there, what Jesus is reminding us of is the failure of Adam to remember God is God and he is not, his wife is not. But Jesus himself says, I don't have that kind of information. The Father has it. And I trust in the Father to provide just what he says he will do in terms of the last day. When is the last day? It doesn't even matter. All that matters is there will be a last day when Christ will return to judge the living and the dead and bring us to that heavenly existence. See the idea? So all the places where Adam has failed, Jesus in terms of his life, Jesus in terms of his ministry, Jesus even in terms of his death, does not fail. He is the righteous man. He is the faithful son. He is the creation that God demanded, desired from the very beginning with Adam. He's the second Adam. And so now we, who are sinners, we who have no position to demand anything from God, because of what Christ has done, have been given everything through Christ, given everything from God, given life, given salvation, given help and aid in this world, given that life to come in the heavenly kingdom. It's never because of anything that we have done. It's never because of anything that we have offered. It's never anything that we could have offered down the road. If you just get me in the church, I promise that I'll do X, Y, and Z, and you'll be pleased. But even from the very beginning, from Adam himself, it's always been God, his love for us, and that trust that we have that God is faithful to his word, faithful to his promises. And in our sinful condition, we are not interested in hearing these kinds of promises. You're not sure if they're true. You're not sure if they're lies. You're not sure if they're real. But you see, the promises of God are not just promises, not just words. They have been incarnated. They have been fulfilled for us in the person of Jesus Christ. Just as real as he was, just as real as his life is, just as real as his death is, just as real as his resurrection is, so is life and salvation for you. They're all the same thing. They all go together. So this is the situation now in which we stand when we see those kinds of chaotic, evil, crazy things going on around us. That none of the things that God has established, granted to us in terms of forgiveness, life, and salvation are affected by these things. Does that mean these things don't pain us and injure us and hurt us? They will certainly do. And that's a part of the fall. But at the same time, what we look forward to, the same time where our faith drives us, at the same time, what we trust in, more than anything else going on in this world, is the promises of God realized and made plain in the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so texts like these, extremely helpful in times like these. Because there's no doubt about the suffering. There's no doubt about the sinful condition. There's no doubt about any of those kinds of foundational questions. They're all true. But the answer to those things, that's what you hear about in the scriptures and the word of God in places like this. The answer to those things is what we find in Christ Jesus. God is not indifferent. God is not satisfied to allow us to suffer in such a way, but he himself bears the consequences. He himself bears them through his son. And so as we go forth from this place, some of us here go forth with no electricity. I've heard the stories here coming in. Trees in the backyard with a whole bunch of wires wrapped around them. Fences destroyed. Houses that are done in. That's real suffering. That's real true stuff. That's going to be a pain in the neck going forward with the insurance costs, right, adjusters, and everything else. That's all true. But know this for certain now. These things are true, even more true than that, and cannot be deprived of you, cannot be taken away. The Christ who came is your Christ. The Christ who died is your Christ. The Christ who rose is your Christ. And because of all those things, you are his and he is yours. And that is the state of affairs forevermore. Forevermore. And so for this Christ and for all that he has done, for all that he teaches us, we offer our thanks. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We rise. In the peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our adoption in Christ Jesus through holy baptism, that by His Spirit we may present ourselves as servants of righteousness, leading to sanctification and its end, eternal life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For laborers in the harvest, that on account of His perfect and life-giving deeds of salvation, Christ's name may be exalted throughout the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all humankind, made in God's image and given this dignity and word, His sight, that His gift of earthly life will be defended at every age, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the government and all in authority, help those who are in need, that they would be granted wisdom and the ability to promote peace and prosperity in our land, and that the word of God would continue to be preached among us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the weary, troubled, sick, and mourning, for those who suffer violence, for those who suffer injury from hurricane, storm, and flood, for those we now name, we pray for Max, Frank, Winnie, Tammy Rose, Rob, Carolyn, Jeanette, Deborah, Kathleen, Gladys, Robin, Mark, Joanne, Teresa, that the Lord would strengthen them to consider their present sufferings in light of the eternal life He gives to the faithful. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who partake of Christ in this blessed sacrament today, that we may be satisfied with His great compassion, receive the forgiveness of our sins, and be strengthened for life and preserved for life everlasting. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O God, whose never-failing providence orders all things both in heaven and on earth, we humbly implore You to put away from us all things, and to give us those things that are profitable for us, through Jesus Christ, Your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with You in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Dear brothers and sisters, I exhort you in Christ that you give attention to the testament of Christ in true faith, and above all, take to heart the words of which Christ presents His body and blood to us for forgiveness, that you take note of and give thanks for the boundless love that He showed us when He saved us from the wrath of God, sin, death, and hell by His blood, and that you then externally receive the bread and wine that is His body and blood as a guarantee and pledge. Let us then, in His name, according to His command, and with His own words, administer and receive the testament. The Lord be with you. Thank you. On the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you. to the Lord, for he is good.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with a salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us, save in faith for you, and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Questions for me, just go ahead and ask me